Thank you for tuning in to Upon the Rock broadcast. I'm your host, Pastor Lawrence Shakir. I believe the Word of God will build a godly foundation in the lives of people. There is more available information on our website. You can log on to shakirministries.org. Now, let's go on to today's message. Around Wednesday or Thursday, I start getting these ideas on what I'm supposed to be talking about. And then God kind of just gets behind it. Yeah, that's good, boy. Go ahead. You know, I get that kind of green light. And yeah, he talked to me like that. But and so I'll come up with a series like dreams. I said, I never talked about dreams, and God put that on my heart to start talking about dreams. So I got excited about it, and he started giving me that series on dreams. And so Wednesday and Thursday rolls around this week, and same thoughts start coming. And I said, and I stopped. I said, wait a minute. I'm not going to think about what I want to talk about. And I kind of paused and I said, Lord, what do you want to say? And at first I didn't hear anything. I just kind of just got some more thoughts about archiving this. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to think about that. I said, Lord, what do you want to say? He didn't say anything. And then more thoughts. I said, I'm not going to move forward at all. If I got to get up there Sunday and just stare at the people, I'm not going to say anything until you say something. About an hour later, God gave me one phrase. He said, who am I? I like that. No, but seriously, he said, who am I? Because we know Jesus, but do we know him? In other words, he asked me the question, who am I to you? And then it made me think about it, because in our religious mind, we go to church on Sundays. We know what the pastor said. We know what our mom says. We got all these prayer people slinging oil on us and everything else. But do we know him in a way like we can give him an answer on who he is? A lot of us can't answer that. And so the teaching I got is called Who Am I? And he just wanted me to talk to you all's head today. Turn one down just a little bit, please. A little more. It's good right there. Everybody say, who am I? Say it again, who am I? That's the question that I believe God is asking each and every one of us today. If you would, with this hour or so, I think I teach about an hour. I always say 45 minutes, but it's always about an hour. With this hour that I give you to talk, I want you to kind of see what is the question that God is asking you. Who am I to you? Am I just somebody you meet on Sunday? Am I just somebody who you just kind of just talk to whenever there's trouble that hit your life? Who am I? And so it says right here in Matthew chapter 16, verse 13 through 60 through 20, excuse me. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? They replied, oh, some say John the Baptist. Others say Elijah. And others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Verse 15, but Jesus, he said, but what about you? He asked, who do you say I am? Everybody say, who do you say I am? He asked the disciples that question. And if you know the story, 11 of them said nothing. And these are people who walked with Jesus. These are not strangers. These are people who walked with him all of this time, saw him cast out devils, saw him heal the sick, saw him break bread, feed thousands. And when he asked them, who am I to you? They said, nothing. I think that's the majority of the church. If 11 out of 12 disciples who walked with him every day didn't know him, what makes you think a lot of us that claim to be Christians, but we don't really know him? Yeah, we know of him. It's Easter coming up, you died on the cross, I'm forgiven. That's all we know. But who is he to you? Who is he as your personal Jesus? A lot of us don't know how to answer that. We just kind of say, I don't know. I mean, I love him, but who is he to you? That's what he wanted me to ask you all. Who am I to you? Am I just a paramedic when you need me in trouble? Do you only serve me because you don't want to go to hell? Who am I? Say out loud, who am I? That's the question that I think, that I hope that will ring in your ear this whole week. As we go to Easter and go through, a lot of us, we don't want to admit it, but we just use God for when we need him, and we put him back when we don't need him. He's not our everything. He's just a thing in our life. None of us want to say that, but that's how the church, the body of Christ, sees him, as just an option, as something that we just kind of just use because this is the way we go to church. Am I talking to y'all? So he said, ask my people, who am I to them? More than just a meeting on Sundays, more than just, I gotta read the Bible. I have to read the Bible. But is he somebody who you want to spend time with? Or do you feel like you have to spend time with him? It's all about perspective. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 2, listen, O heavens, pay attention. This is God talking. Pay attention, earth, or people, or body of Christ. This is what the Lord says. The children I've raised and cared for have rebelled against me. Even the ox knows its owner. Even the donkey knows its master. But my people don't recognize my care for them, or my people don't know me. But the ox knows his master, and the donkey knows his master. They know who's in control, and they know how to submit. But my people who are called by my name, they know of me, but they don't know me. I'm just somebody in the sky who they claim they pray to. And yes, you do pray to him. But a lot of us don't have a relationship with him like we have with like our spouse or our best friend or even a coworker at work. We don't have a relationship with God like that. We know him as the big boss, the man upstairs, the guy who rules the universe. But you don't sit down and pull up a chair and talk to him. You don't know his personality. You don't know what breaks his heart. You don't know what makes him smile, you know? So he keep asking the question, who am I to you? Get away from me. I'm trying to distract me. He says, who am I? And that's, I'm not trying to put this music on to make you go to sleep. I want you all to think that he's trying to echo his voice to you out of all of the cares of the world that you have going to work Monday in, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, all the events, all of the dreams, all the plans you have. Is he part of your life, or is he your life? Okay? Is he somebody who you can, you know, talk to him when nothing is going on? You know? Do you have to watch TV all day? Do you have to listen to that? Do you gotta work on this all day? Can you just stop and just turn off the phone, myself included, turn off the phone and just sit with him? Because I think the reason why the body of Christ and our church, reason why we have trouble worshiping God, is because we have trouble worshiping him at home. We don't spend time with him at home. And it's difficult to do it in public when you don't have it in private. It's very difficult. Now, you can fake it, but it won't reach your heart because you have no private worship. You don't know him. You don't spend time with him the way he's desiring. So he says, the ox, the donkey, these are wild animals, but at least they know who's in charge. They know how to submit, but not my people. I raised them. I cared for them, and they still rebelled against me. They're too busy. They don't have time for me. I blessed them so much. Now they don't even want to turn and say thank you. They're like the 9 lepers that went, and only one came back and said thanks for that. He said, that is my people right there. But I still care for them. I still love them, even if they don't love me back the way I want them to love me back. all of us is guilty of this, myself included. We can make more time for God than we like. Sometimes we just choose not to. So he says, again, who am I? You didn't walk with me, talk with me. Got him. I think I got him. No, I didn't. Oh my goodness, he's still around. And this is not to put anybody on blast. I just think that this is something that God is saying, I'm trying to get something to you, but I'm not going to give you anything if you don't know me. Y'all get it? In Matthew chapter 7, this scripture right here is very scary to me. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 23. Not everyone who calls me Lord, Lord will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father. Everybody say, do the will of my Father. Father in heaven will enter. Verse 22. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, we've prophesied in your name. We cast out devils in your name. We went to church. We read our Bibles. We did all kinds of things in your name, performed mighty miracles in your name. But I will reply, the Amplified says, I will tell them openly and plainly, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. I never knew you. It's frightening to spend your whole life trying to keep up with God, and you get there to the finish line, and he says, I don't even know who you are. You never spent time with me. You clocked in time for kingdom things, but you never spent time with me. So you can lay hands, you can preach, you can prophesy, you can do all of these things, but if you don't spend time with me, I don't know you. You're just another stranger. And so he asked the same question to generations of people. Who am I to you? Don't tell me what your grandma told you. Don't tell me what your pastor told you. Who am I to you? Because if you can't answer that question, what makes you think he can give you anything if you don't even know him? You don't even have a relationship with him. And he says right here, many will say this. And he said, I will plainly tell them, I never knew you. But Lord, look at all this kingdom work I've been doing for you. And all these souls got saved under my ministry. And all these people got, you know, talked to. And the kingdom was expanded. But God says, yeah, but I never knew you. They got in, but you didn't get in because you were playing around with me. You only used me to make your name great. You didn't make my name great, but the kingdom got the benefit, but you didn't get the benefit because you don't know me. So we keep asking the question again over to generations, who am I? Who am I? And a lot of disciples, again, they said absolutely nothing. Because I know about you, Lord, but I don't know you. I know a few scriptures, but I really don't take time to hear from you. Amen? And here's going back to that story. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah. To me, Lord, you are the Messiah, or the Son of God, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but my Father in heaven. In other words, that's called revelation knowledge. Nobody told you, Simon. You got that from God. All this time you walking with me, God downloaded something in you, and now you are revealed on who I really am. Y'all get that? And so he says, you're blessed because God has revealed to you who I really am to you. But you know what? I was hesitant to put pictures up here like this. Why? Because some people only serve Jesus by what they think he is. Well, I only serve him because he's my, or no, I'm gonna say it like this, obvious. Some people get offended at Jesus because you have a Caucasian man that always plays him with long hair. And they say, Jesus was a black man. Okay. Hispanics say Jesus was Mexican. Okay. Everybody claims him as their race because they want some type of sense of ethnic pride about him. They have more faith in the color of his skin than the blood that saved him. As if the color of his skin saved you. And so they will only put him in a category in a way that I can receive him. And then God says, who am I to you? Am I just somebody who had to fit in your little square, your little box, your little corner? And so, you know, I get people that get offended at me because they want to go on all these debates about stuff that don't even matter, about dumb stuff, just dumb stuff. And I don't even respond to them because they don't even know that they're being sidetracked by the enemy. It's not even foundational. And so they get caught up in all the color, not even knowing that it was the blood that was the most important thing. It was the blood. That's why Jesus, in the Gospels, they didn't describe his ethnicity while he walked the earth. Now, I know they described his resurrected body, but they didn't describe how he looked while he walked the earth because he didn't want people to get in pride. Because nobody can put a claim on Jesus. He's for all of us. But if you let that spirit of hate come in and division that says he's like me and that makes me superior, you got the spirit of, yeah, that's the spirit of hate. And that's why he didn't claim himself to be like that. Oh, I'm gonna get some hate letters off this one. I won't respond, thank you. So he says right here, I'm gonna go back because that was something I want to say here. He says, flesh and blood did not reveal that to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. See, at first he was just named Simon, but he called him Peter, which means rock, or a fragment of a rock, or a piece of a stone. That's what Peter means. And he says, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail or overcome it. I'm gonna go back. You are Peter. Because of that revelation, I'm gonna put something inside of you so strong that no devil in hell can break you away from me. Yeah, you may fall, you may deny me a few times, but you will not go back astray. And you know what? I think that's an excellent thing for the Lord to tell each one of us, that he's making us a rock, that we will not go astray. I have been in ministry long enough to have the pleasure and the pain of seeing a lot of people come to Christ, but I've seen a lot of people walk away. Me and my wife will tell you. And I had a friend that I grew up, well, I didn't say grew up because I grew up in California. But when I came to Memphis, I went to high school and I made some friends and we kind of grew. And this one particular guy, we're gonna call him Ray. He was a good guy. He kind of had his own trouble, you know. He would sell drugs and run around with a whole bunch of girls and everything. But this was around the time I got born again and got involved with ministry. And so Ray, he got saved at one of those crusades. And the fire of God was on him. He was so excited. He was lifting his hands and he contacted me and I was telling the church that I was attending. And he started coming to that church and he was there every Sunday, lifting his hands and going on fire for God. And he just loving the Lord and, you know, got married and everything. And everybody loved Ray. We went to his wedding and everything, right? And we went to his wedding and he was just on fire for God. But one thing he didn't know how to build a relationship with God. He knew church, he knew people, he knew some scriptures, but he never took the time to build his own godly foundation, which is the reason why I started naming the church this, because I've seen a lot of people start out and then just go astray. So Ray, after like a little over a year or so, he started developing he started having the regular storms of life that hit everybody. And Ray would, you know, contact me and contact other people. And God will always put people in a position where they can't help you because God wants to be the one that helps you. He don't want anybody else to get the glory but him. So he will kind of keep people back from helping you because he wants you to establish a relationship with him so you can know him. So Ray would call and talk and we would do what we can but we couldn't help them out of some of the stuff, because some of the seeds you've sown, I'm not saying they come at the harvest, but Satan will try to visit that harvest and try to allow you to experience some of that. Even though you are the righteousness of God and you're redeemed by the blood, sometimes he will try to bring back some of that stuff that kind of will get you off track. So Ray was having all of these harvests from the world. And again, we tried to do what we can. And I noticed Ray, I watched him, how he will get bitter and angry and resentful because these church folk are not here for me. He had his trust in man instead of God. And then more and more, I would listen to him as he talked. He would say, I hate this and I hate that and I hate this. And little by little by little by little, I saw how that fire that he had was starting to go out, and it was more of the world coming in. And we would pray for him and everything like that. His wife would contact us and we would pray and we, you know. But since Ray never took the time to kind of just go down and dig deep and know who Christ was for real, it was only a matter of time that we found out that Ray was right back in the world, selling drugs again, lost his family, lost, you know, his marriage, and doing all kinds of crazy things all over again. And this was a guy who had strong potential for God. I mean, strong potential. But he never took the time to know him on his own, never. He put his trust in people. And people will always disappoint you. And so what happened is, Peter said this, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, you're blessed because you established some kind of relationship that God has revealed something to you. Now, off that revelation, I'm going to build my church off that revelation. Off that revelation, I'm going to build a kingdom project inside of you that the gates of hell will not overcome it. And sometimes, when you really know who God is, it's almost like it solidifies your walk with God for the rest of your life. Once you really know him, you don't have to worry about, oh my goodness, am I going to just serve him for a few years and then go back out into the world? If you really know him, it kind of guarantees you're on this thing forever. But you know what? Majority of the body of Christ don't get there. So they serve him for a season while it's convenient. While everything is going, if I got a hard time, I need the Lord, that's all I got. But then he starts blessing you and you just forget all about him. And it happens over and over and over and over and over and over again. And so he says, you know me, Peter. The rest of the disciples, they, you know, and I can take you through the scriptures. When Gethsemane, when they, you know, took Jesus, the Bible said all the disciples left him, but Peter followed from a distance. Every single disciple kind of went back to their own life. But Peter followed at a distance. Yeah, he fell away too, but he was still following at a distance. I'm just taking my time. Forgive me if I'm talking too slow. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom off that revelation. Because you have taken the time to know me, I'm going to give you a key that I can't give to everybody else. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loose in heaven. Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Why? How come you can't tell anybody? Because they need to learn how to know God for themselves. They got to dig deep and learn how to know him like you did, Peter. So don't tell anybody who I am. Don't spoil it for them. Let them, if they're serious about it, then you let them get on their knees. You let them open that Bible. You let them go on a fast if they're serious about it. Don't try to help everybody out. You can't help everybody. They either got to have it, or they want it, or they don't want it. And you can't make anybody want something that they don't want. Not even a baby. If a baby is full and you're trying to feed them something, they're not going to eat it. If you know that as a young child, then you ought to know that when you get older, especially if you grow in the things of God. If you don't feed yourself on the Word of God, you will starve. And when you starve, all of that world stuff's coming right back. You can always tell when you're drifting, when you're easily this and easily that, you probably haven't spent time in the Word in a while. And so your spirit is crying out. And that's why you get bitter and angry. Because all of this time, you're trusting in people instead of trusting in God. People can't save you. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth, be bound in heaven. Verse 20 again. Then he ordered his disciples, or he commanded them, not to tell anyone he was the Messiah. I want God to reveal it to them. I want my Father to reveal it to them. Because even if you do tell them, they're not going to listen. Because some people are bent on being stupid. Thank you, Lord. It came out just like that. That's why it's supposed to come out. Some people are bent on being stupid. And you have to let them. Forrest Gump said it best. Stupid is, stupid does. You got to let them be stupid until they find their own way. And I like this part here. I had to put this in. I almost didn't put it in, but I want to put this in here. Jesus just got through telling Peter that you got this revelation. God's going to build this thing. I'm going to build something in you, and you will not fall away. And you know what happens? We get puffed up when we hear that. Oh, I got revelation knowledge. I'm guilty of it. Everybody's guilty of it. I got revelation knowledge. Anything I say maybe is going to be right then. That's what happens. You start getting to the point when God starts revealing, starts blessing, you would think that, oh, I'm pretty special. You think you're special. And so, verse 21, from then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples, this is the same chapter, next verse, from then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem, that he would suffer many terrible things at the hands of the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of the religious law. He will be killed, but the third day he will be raised again. Now, he just got through telling Peter, raised again. Y'all know me. I mean, sometimes I can be a little ignorant. I don't know why but anyway, I'm here. God put me in this chair. Even though I got bad grammar, hey, he used the foolish things of the world. I'm saying that. Let me keep going. All right, so he will be killed. But on the third day, he will be raised from the dead. Peter heard that, and he had the nerve. Peter took him to the side and began to rebuke Jesus. What's wrong with this boy? What in the world? How in the world? You got to be double dumb to rebuke Jesus. Now, Jesus just told him, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. You're blessed. God revealed this to you. He thought, okay, I'm so revealed. I got enough strength to rebuke you, Jesus. Oh, this boy done went. He done shot off. He done shot off. But listen, he began to rebuke Jesus, saying things, heaven forbid, this will never happen to you. But Jesus turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. See, in other words, you don't know that anything that you don't agree with doesn't mean that you're right. You're not going to be right in everything you do because you got a little revelation knowledge. You're going to get off sometimes. And so when you get off, I'm going to be there to straighten you out because I know you like that. And every now and then God will rebuke you and say, no, that ain't you. That's the devil in you. And you got to be like, oh, forgive me. You thought it was right. The Bible said a fool is right in his own eyes. But every now and then God will say, you're off. You're getting off. You're off. You're off. He'll tell you that. And if you're sensitive to hear him, you will make the necessary changes. If not, then you're gonna keep getting off until you fall off, like my friend Ray did. And I think he can come back, but I think it may be a little bit tougher for him to get back because of some of his wrong expectations. Am I talking to you all so far? I'm just talking. So he rebuked Jesus, and he really thought he was right to rebuke Jesus. After all, Jesus told me how spiritual I am. I might as well rebuke you because I'm the one that you just said that I'm, on top of everything. But watch this. The reason why Jesus rebuked him, he says, you are a dangerous trap for me. You are seeing things merely from human point of view and not from God's perspective. You still got to dig deeper, Peter. I know you got a lot of revelation knowledge, but you have not hit the ceiling. So you got to keep digging and keep digging. And then one day you can qualify for the day of Pentecost, but you got to keep digging. Don't just think you got a little knowledge of him and you can just stay right there. It's not going to happen. If you don't keep digging, you can still fall off because pride has lifted you up. And so now you're top heavy. And so it was necessary for Jesus to rebuke him back because he was off. And a lot of times we as children of God, ministers, pastors, preachers, we get off. And we need him to rebuke us. But if you don't know him, you're not going to feel that check in your spirit. He needs to rebuke you when you get away from your word. You haven't spent time in your word. You need to pray and you need to get in the word again. Only when you know him, you can hear that. You need to fast. Oh, Lord, I rebuke that. No, don't rebuke that. You need to fast. And you need to be able to be sensitive enough and say, Lord says it's time for me to fast. You know? Yeah, get back in church. A lot of times that's how most of us came. We felt a call, like you need to get back into the things of God because you're drifting away. And then you have to respond to that, and then because God is trying to bless your life according to that. But if you're not sensitive to know him, those words, even though he's saying those words, it's gonna go right over your head. It's not gonna get you to your heart. It's gonna go over your head. Are y'all getting this? Say out loud, who am I? That's the question he's asking you. Who am I? And you know what? Some people, this is Jesus. I'm the paramedic. When I'm in trouble, Lord, when a storm hit my house, a financial storm hit my house, or a sickness hit my house, yeah, I'm going to pray to you because I need you. I'm dialing 911. You need to come over here now. That's who Jesus is to some people. He's just a paramedic. Or he's a business deal. Ooh, I got to make sure I stay in my Bible. I got to make sure I do this because I don't want to go to hell. I don't want to be living a life of lack. So let me make sure I do the right things to get the right checks on my calendar because I don't want to be bad. I don't want to look like I'm a bad person. So let me just do this. My heart's not in it, but let me just do it anyway because I know that I just need to do this. So yeah, I'll go to church. I don't want to go to church, but I'll go because I don't want to be a heathen. So he's like a business deal. Or he's like a dog in a corner. Get in your corner, God. Get in your corner. Why? Because I want my own life, but at the same time, you need to stay over there and don't disrupt my life. You know, I got everything nice and neat. I don't need you coming in here wrecking the whole house. Get in your corner, God. So I'll put you on a leash and just say, yeah, I got God, but you really don't have him. You just have him in an area of your life that you can control and maintain. But he's not the Lord of your life. He's just a pet in your life. Are y'all okay? All right. So is he a pet in your life that you just kind of just take to the park and show him off and say, yeah, I got Jesus. Look at my cross on my neck. Look at me, look at what I'm doing, or is he really Lord of your life? A lot of people don't see him as Lord. They just see him as man's best friend. That's all they see him as. Bondsman. What is it called again? Bail bondsman. Okay, I was right when I put that in Google. What you know about bail bondsman? I'm just joking. I had to throw that out there. Something you want to tell us, maybe? No, I'm just playing. But anyway, let's get back in the spirit. Bail bondsman, I'm in trouble. I'm handcuffed. I got all of these things. Lord, you need to help me now. I don't want to be in prison. So he helps you. He bails you out. And then that's the last time you see him because he bailed you out. And that's who Jesus is to a lot of people. It's just somebody who gets me out of a pinch because trouble has hit my house. So I need a bail bondsman to get me out of this. Get me out, Jesus. Get me out today. Old school songs. Some of y'all would know and some of you don't. Or that. Who is he? Santa Claus. You go down your whole long list of I want this, this, that, 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 that. He's a genie in a bottle. He's a Santa Claus who come down your chimney. You just feed him milk and cookies. With your little group, when we just give them milk and cookies. Sometimes we just kind of just, whatever you, okay, God, I here, take this. Milk and cookies. Bernie Mac.
I want some milk and cookies. I know. You heard that too?
Oh, Lord. Anyway.
I just want some milk and cookies.
And that's how you see Jesus as, I'm just going to give you my list. I want a spouse. I want a house. I want the career. I want this. I want that. I want that. And he got to sit there, look at your list, but you don't do anything for him. So it's no corresponding action. And he's just Santa Claus to you. Anytime you pray, you don't pray and say, Lord, I don't want anything. I just want to just thank you. You don't pray like that. You say, Lord, I want this. I want that. I want that. Amen. Then you feel like I've done my prayer time. That ain't no prayer time. That's a list. That's a Santa Claus list. You don't just sit there and just say, Lord, I love you. Lord, help me with this sin. Help me with this issue. Help me with that. You don't do that. You pray for the things you want. And then you get mad at him when he don't deliver. But you never deliver on your part. Or Black Jesus. Black Jesus. Mexican Jesus. Hispanic Jesus. Everybody want to claim him because I want that pride that's saying that I'm of the race of Jesus. But you don't care about the blood. You care about the color. And so your focus is off. Because when you get to heaven, the Bible says you're going to see him as he really is. And you're like, oh, Lord. Because what if he comes to you in the color of water? That'd be cool, won't it? That'd be awesome. But he probably is not caught up on a color. I like my brown chocolate skin. I do. But I don't think that I am better than my Caucasian brothers, my Hispanic brothers. We're all part of the body, you know? And so I think a lot of us get off on the image of God. And so, you know, I get complaints. Why you put a white Jesus up there? Why you gotta do a white Jesus? Oh, shut up. I just wanna tell him, shut up. But I don't say that because I'm a pastor. But I wanna say it. Then repent later. But it doesn't matter if he had blue polka dot skin. If he's the Son of God and if his blood saved you, then that's all that matters. So who is he to you? And you know what? As I looked at these things, paramedic, business deal, co-pilot or whatever, it's not that he's not that. He can be that too. If you know him, if you just see him as just a paramedic, something's wrong. If you just see him as Santa Claus, something's wrong. But if you know him, you spend time with him, he can be that. He can be that. He can be that. He can be that. He can be all of these things if you just know him. So it's nothing wrong with seeing him that way if you have a relationship with him. Y'all hear me? We get out of balance and we only just see him as just that, but we have no relationship with him. And so my prayer is that if you all get this word and digest it, that you will just know him and then he will reveal himself as all of these other things. It's more than that. I just put up these just to give you an idea. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. And you know, yes, we're in the last days. You see all kind of foolishness in the body of Christ and you just know, oh, we're in the last days. I mean, yeah, anytime you see pastors or preachers fighting against each other and church folk, you know, going to town and, you know, it's just crazy out there. It's getting real bad out there. But he said in the last days, it'll be difficult times for people will love only themselves. It'll be a selfish generation that will emerge that all they think about is just themselves and their money. All they want is what's going to make me happy, what's going to make me fulfilled, what's going to give me more money. They will be boastful, they'll be proud, they'll be scoffing at God, disobedient to parents, they'll be ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They don't care what it is. It's not sacred. If it don't make money, it don't make sense, and I don't care about this Bible, I just care about my own needs. And that's what's wrong with the body of Christ right now. We are foolish. We got a lot of foolishness going on, looking just like this. All of us are looking like this because we just think that God's going to bless whatever we do, And so if I got a problem with you, I'm going to just slap the taste out your mouth. And so that's what the church looks just like the world now. The church looks just like the world. And it's wrong. It's wrong for the church to look like that. We ought to be peculiar. Now, we have to be a bit like them to win them, but we should not be just like them. And the Bible said, let the redeemer of the Lord say so. But when you say so, you ought to show so as well. You know, don't just say it, show it. Because me personally, I almost get nauseated when people come up to me and my wife talking about, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. We're like, oh Jesus. Because sometimes you have to ask them, what kind of Christian are you? It's sad, but you got to ask that now. Because you get people, because that's why I try not to tell people, not that I'm ashamed of my calling, but I try not to tell people what I do. Because when people put on, when they see you as that, they got to show you how spiritual they are, but they can't deliver. Yeah, it's like competition, but at the same time, they want to be a Christian or whatever, but they're so full of the flesh that it's like you making the rest of us look bad. And so they're like this. They don't see themselves like that, but that's how they look. And the Bible talks about that they're just lovers of themselves. And these are the times that we're living in right now. He said they will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. Whatever they want to do, they're just going to go ahead and do it. They will be cruel and hate what is good. You know, some people hate the fact that, well, it's a lot of things they hate. I mean, we live in a society of haters. But just because you are somebody who don't cuss or smoke or fight or, you know, you have a level head on your shoulders, you get some people that just hate that you're not like them. So you go to work, you clock in and you do your job right, and they got a problem with you because you walk with integrity. Because they want you to be late and crazy and stupid like them, gossiping like everybody else. But when you set a standard, it causes other people to hate you because you're trying to live for God. Anybody ever experienced that before? It makes you isolated a little bit. But if you know your God, God's going to always be your friend, you know? But anyway, they will hate what is good. They will betray their friends. They will be reckless, puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, holy, deep, sanctimonious, but they will reject the power that will make them godly. So they may look good and they may shine and they may have a lot of stuff that looks all nice, but they're not, they're walking in the flesh, but they're walking in the flesh. And again, I've been in ministry long enough to see all kinds of faces. And you show people who you are. You don't tell them. If you are a loving person, let your fruit show it. You ain't got to tell anybody anything, because time will tell what kind of person you are. And so if you are the redeemer of the Lord, say so and do so. Because sooner or later, somebody going to say something to you and you're going to be looking just like this. Oh, sister so-and-so, brother so-and-so, I saw them scrapping. You know, came from California. That's that California. Verse 5, they will act religious, but they will reject the power that make them godly. Stay away from people like that. When you see people that are just fleshy, the Bible says you do your part by staying away from people like that, because bad company will always corrupt good character. So you got to watch who you're hanging around. I don't care how sanctimonious they say they are. If you see fruit like this, you need to get away from them. Because everything that looks good is not good. Everything that looks God is not from God. So stay away. Everybody say, stay away. Say it again, stay away. Now that's something that you got to do then. Last scripture. And I love this scripture. I don't love it, but I think this one scripture in the Bible speaks volumes. The Bible talks about that Paul, y'all know the Apostle Paul, right? He did so much for the body of Christ. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. So he had companions, almost like disciples, if you think about it. He had disciples that followed him around too. And he had a lot of heartache, shipwrecks, getting beat, what rods and everything. But actually, when they threw Paul in prison, and he was basically sit there to rot or until they cut his head off, a lot of his so-called disciples decided to just go away, just start to desert him, why? Because the thrill was gone. You're in jail now, there's nothing else we can gain from this, so I think I'm gonna go back. And one guy, Demas, in chapter 4, verse 10, he was writing a letter to Timothy, which is his apprentice, and he said, Demas has deserted me because he loves the things of this life or the things of this world and has gone to Thessalonica. And that scripture always jumps out to me because time will tell where somebody's heart is at. So this person decided to go back into the world, just like my friend Ray. He was doing real good, following Paul, doing all of this stuff. I mean, this is Paul now. And some of you all that probably don't do a whole lot of deep studying on this, you probably wouldn't recognize how powerful Paul's ministry was, but he was like the Pope or the apostle for the Gentiles. And so this guy was going all over the place. He did more for the body of Christ than the people who walked with Jesus. He didn't even see Jesus, but he did more than those other 12 disciples. And so Demas had the privilege of following this guy around. But when the thrill was gone, Demas said, I think I'm going back into the world. And he left Paul. The Bible says he deserted me because he loves the things of this world. He's chasing after that money. Go ahead, chase it, Demas. See how it's going to work out for you. But he went back into the world. And Paul wrote that in the letter to Timothy, that this guy has deserted me. He didn't curse him. He didn't say anything else. He just said, this guy just went back into the world. And that one scripture, like I said, speaks volumes. Because I've seen a lot of people come to the body, but I've seen a lot of people like Demas that just desert and go back because, you know, this thing is not like I thought it should be. I'm going back into the world where it was safe. And so they leave, they go back. And that's why Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 through 2 is so important. He says, so we must listen very carefully to the truth that we have heard. In other words, if you have the word of God, the truth right here, the Bible says you need to listen to it, or what we have heard, or we may not drift, away from it. You have potential of drifting away from the things of God if you stay away from the word. The more you stay away from the word, you're just like this boat that's drifting away. You think you're on solid ground because you're just stable and you're not getting wet and you're not drowning, but you have no idea that you're starting to drift from the things of God. And so you once close to the shore like this, but then you start to fall asleep on God a little bit and stop reading your Bible and you stop praying, stop coming to church, stop doing this, stop. And then all of a sudden you're drifting. And it's like, I hate these things or I hate this. And then you see yourself like, how did I get here? Well, you stopped doing a lot of things. And so now you're drifting from the shore. And the Bible says you got to pay careful attention to the truth that you have heard. Otherwise, you're going to drift. For this message that God delivered through angels has always stood firm. I love that. It always stood firm. There's always a foundation to it. And every violation of the law and every act of disobedience was punished. People think they can get over on God. You're not going to get over on God. So you got to pay careful attention. Everybody say careful attention. Because you will drift. If you don't remember anything, please remember that verse. I'm so tired of seeing people drift back out into the world, I don't even know what to do anymore. All I can do is just pray. Because I've seen it too many times because people don't know Him. They don't know Him. They have a form of knowing about Him, but they don't know Him. I thank God that guy put that gun to my head. It forced me to know God. It forced me to hear His voice. If that hadn't happened, I probably wouldn't be here today. I would have been another guy to kind of just, oh, I tried that thing. But thank God He put some roots inside of me. And so you need roots. And I know what I'm talking about. You need roots. Say out loud, I need roots. And some of you have roots, but you need deeper roots because the kind of calling that God has for you and the assignment He has for your life, He's not going to just give it to any little thing that has little roots. You need deep roots. Like those palm trees, when the hurricane comes, they can bend all the way down to the ground and come right back up. Why? Because they had strong roots. And that's what separates them from every other tree. They're made for the storm. So the Lord is asking you, who am I to you? If you don't know the answer to that question, then you got some homework then. Y'all got homework. If you don't know the answer to that, if you can't say like Peter said, that you are this to me, then you better be careful, because probably Satan has got something on you to pull you away. And I know we all in church and we love the Lord, but if you don't go home and develop a relationship yourself, you're not gonna last. You gotta have your own, I tell you all the time, you gotta have your own devotion, you gotta have your own worship time, you gotta have your own Bible study. You can't depend on 1 hour from a preacher that's gonna take 150 hours a week. Take that 1 hour, that is not gonna cut it. You gotta sow seeds of God's time in you, in your life. Because it's easy for us to get up here and sing songs for you. And you have to just sit there and just kind of like, okay, yeah. It's easy for you to just sit there and listen to me, but you got to go home. And so, myself included, I have to do this. And I'm asking you all to do the same thing. Because we only go to God when it's special occasions. Yeah, Easter's coming up. People go to church on Easter, Mother's Day. We do things because we are just used to doing things a certain way. But we don't know him, so we go right back out into the world like Demas, and we don't see them again. God don't see them again in the house of God till next year. And I'm tired of it. I'm sorry. I'm just tired of it. So who am I? Say out loud, who am I? Are you the guy on this road by yourself, walking down the road and don't even know where you're going? Because he will be with you. But you gotta have a focus of who he is and where you're going. And if you don't know, he will reveal it.
Thank you for listening to Upon the Rock broadcast. If this message has been a blessing, you can help us spread the gospel by sharing this message with your friends. Also, if you're online, please be sure to contact me, either through our website at shakirministries.org or through social media. I would love to hear from you. Together, we can build a godly foundation in the lives of people. Until next time, please know that I'm praying for you, and I hope to see you on our next broadcast.